The whole thing is very surreal to me. What happened is years ago, I left graduate school in computer science to go write for The Simpsons, and I started hiding little jokes in the background that were math equations and physics equations, thinking that a few of my friends, like six people, would see them and appreciate them, and they'd be way in the back and nobody would think about it again. So then cut to 20 years later, Simon Singh writes this book on the subject, and suddenly everybody knows about it, and I'm coming to London to talk about it, so I didn't see it coming. The one I'm proudest of is, it's in the episode Homer Cubed, which is part of one of the Halloween shows, and it's an equation which seems to disprove Fermat's last theorem, which is a famous mathematical theorem that went unproven for hundreds of years and then was finally proven in the mid-90s by a mathematician, Andrew Weil. So I did an equation in the background of that that to eight decimal places appeared to disprove this theorem. And so if you tried it on a standard calculator at that time, you would go, what's going on? This can't be true. It proves the theorem is false. And I thought a few people would notice it, but actually this is right around the dawn of internet discussion, and so I checked the internet the next day, and people were talking about it and going like, I tried it can't be true, and I was like, yeah, I did it. You know? That's my proudest math moment in The Simpsons.
Can you talk about just how big a role maths and physics and your passion for that had in the birth of Futurama?
Futurama is, it's actually a weird mix. It's science and science fiction, and of course it's supposed to be comedy when we do our job well, so it's a weird combination. There's not a lot of things in that category, comedy science or comedy science fiction, so there weren't a lot of role models, and I think it took us a little while to figure out how to do that. But I think what ultimately happened is the more seriously we took the math and the science and the science fiction element, the better the comedy worked too, because we had sort of this serious setup side, and then the characters' petty concerns play very well as comedy against, you know, the fate of the universe and billions of years of history and that kind of stuff. So really what we found to our surprise is take the science seriously, take the science fiction seriously, and the whole show works better that way.
I mean, much like the fate of the universe, people are always unsure if Futurama is imploding or exploding. Yeah. What does the future hold for the series at the moment? Because obviously it's been brought back to life so many times by fans. What's the status at the moment?
Yeah, well, you know, I consider it the last episode ever. Anytime we write an episode, thinking at the time we write it that it's going to be the last episode ever. So by that criterion, that we've written the last episode ever four times at this point. And I think when you're getting really good at writing the last episode ever of your show, that's a very bad sign. Something has gone horribly wrong at that point. So each time it's been canceled in the past, I always said, well, I don't really think there's any chance it's going to come back. So that's still how I feel now, but somehow nobody believes me anymore when I say that.
I mean, obviously, you know, we love Futurama. I think Fry and Leela, their relationship and the kind of evolving nature of that over the course of the series and the films has been fascinating. Can you just talk a little bit about that part of the show?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked about that, because that's another thing in terms of it being a comedy that originally we thought, oh, we'll have Fry be this idiot and he has a crush on Leela. He wants to win Leela's love. But we didn't take it that seriously because we just thought, oh, Fry's a moron. He has no chance. And then the fans really responded to that and to all the emotion in the show in general. And when we started to see that the fans were enjoying that aspect of the show, we were willing to go for more emotional, more touching episodes, sometimes even tragic, horribly tragic episodes, dead dogs, for example, for anyone who knows the dead dog episode. So by the end, we were like, people are invested in this relationship. So we actually tried to make Fry mature a little bit and become a little better person, so he had a chance to genuinely win Leela over by the end.
From a maths point of view, Bender is amazing for no other reason than there's, I think at this point, about 2,300% of him of all the things. That's in. Can you talk a little bit about that creation of that guy?
Yeah, you know, we had a joke in some early episode that he's 40%. I don't even remember what his first element was that he was 40%. There was a shortage of what metal, palladium or something, platinum. Bender's like, I'm 40%. Platinum, and he sold his body, and then did another show where he was on the show Iron Chef, if anybody knows the Japanese cooking show, and he goes in the show Iron Chef. He said, I'm 30% iron. So it became a running joke that anytime some element came up, Bender was usually 40%, occasionally other percents made of that metal, and yeah, eventually added up to well beyond 100%, which in the future makes perfect sense. Just take my word for it. No more questions. usually I think of an episode called The Luck of the Fryrish as my favorite, and I don't know if it's actually the best one, but I have such fond memories of it. The reason being, I talked about a minute ago about how we started to do more emotional episodes, and early on we didn't do too many because we were worried, we got to keep this funny and, you know, not shoot in too many directions at once. But we decided we would try with that episode a touching thing where Fry learns about his brother who's been dead for 972 years or whatever it is at this point. And it's actually kind of sad, and we thought, like, we didn't know if people were going to go for it or not. And it was very tricky to write because it had a lot of flashbacks, but it ended up working well after all my concern about it. And I really liked it, and then the fans really liked it. So it gave us the confidence to do more episodes like that. So looking back, that was a turning point in the show for me. And so I think that's my number one, probably. Messages, thank you, basically, because, you know, we, 10 years ago at this point, wherever we hugged each other and said goodbye at the Futurama offices, because that was cancellation number one. And it was certainly in the history of TV, it's very rare in the U.S., at least, for a show to come back after it's gone, and we didn't expect it. And it was just fan love that brought us back. You know, people kept watching reruns, buying DVDs, and showing up at book signings like this one. And so they took notice and brought us back. And same thing again, like, people would not let it die. So I owe the fans for several good runs of employment, so thank you. As far as what we still could do, you know, I'll be honest, I feel like this is the first cancellation where I feel like the show now is a full body of work. Every time before I felt like, oh, if only we could have gone a little further, but now I feel like I'm proud of it as a whole package. And we did 140 episodes if you count the DVD movies as episodes, and why not do that? So that's, you know, by any normal standard, that's a great run. When you compare it to The Simpsons, it seems like it was canceled in its infancy, but by any normal human standards, it's been a good run. So for the first time, I feel really proud of it and satisfied with where it's ended up. But could it go on? You know, it's about the universe and the future, so that is a limitless supply of material.
Good news, everyone, you can buy the DVDs.